to the sacred hymns and songs. When you appear on the last day, the sign of your cross will shine brighter than the sun. Gather us before you and surround us with your eternal light, that we may raise glory and thanks to you, to your Father, and to you, Holy Spirit, forever.
Thank you.
Jesus Christ, our Lord, accept these prayers in the fragrance of the incense that we have offered on the feast of the exaltation of your holy cross. May its sign always be visible before our eyes to strengthen us, that we may walk with you toward death, and then stand at your right hand to celebrate the feast of your eternal victory. We glorify you, your Father and your Holy Spirit, forever.
Rather, if your enemy is hungry, feed them. If he is thirsty, give him something to drink. For by doing so, you will heap burning coals upon his head. Do not be conquered by evil, but conquer evil with good.
Praise be to God always.
Peace be with you.
the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Dostoevsky, the Russian author, in one of his works, he reports a story from the Russian folklore of an old woman who died, and she was a nasty piece of work. This lady was always crabby, always complaining, and she died, like we all do. And as she lay in the fires, Dostoevsky writes, her guardian angel approached God and said, isn't there something that I can do for her? And God answered by saying to the angel, well, surely she must have done something good in her life. And he said, she once gave an onion to a beggar. And God said, well, try that. And he goes to the fires, and he holds out an onion to this woman in the fires. And she grabs at the onion, and as he begins to pull her out and she hangs onto the onion, others, the souls in these fires, see her leaving. And they come forward, they try to grab onto her, and also go out with her. And she begins to kick them and say, no, no, it's mine, it's mine, it's mine. And at that point, the onion broke, and she and all of them fell back into the fires. We'll come back to this in a moment. In this parable, of course, this is the last judgment. And it strikes us because our Lord gives us the judgment. Corporal works of mercy. But what really strikes us as amazing is neither the righteous or the damned seem to have an idea of why our Lord is blessing or cursing them. Because both of them ask the question, when did we see you in this instance and feed you? When did we see you homeless and give you shelter? And the damned say, the goats say the same thing. When did we see you and not do this for you? Both of them are not recognizing these corporal works of mercy. And yet our Lord puts this whole thing in the parable of the Day of Judgment. As we mentioned to you a few weeks ago, this is the end of chapter 25 of St. Matthew. 24, 25, and then all of these parables we've been looking at over these last weeks. And in chapter 26 will open our Lord's Passion, his betrayal, his condemnation, and crucifixion. So our Lord is bringing together something for us to understand. When we look at the Sermon on the Mount, which is the same Gospel of St. Matthew, chapters 5, 6, and 7. We know it well because we all know the beginning of it. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of God. We know this. But it goes on for three chapters. And there is a point towards the end of it in which our Lord says to them, be you perfect as your heavenly Father is perfect. Now our Lord is not saying become God. That doesn't make any sense. No one's going to become divine. But we can become God-like. And so what does he mean when he says, be you perfect as your heavenly Father is perfect? He explains. He says that God makes the sun to rise upon the just and the unjust. That he has his rain fall upon both the righteous and sinners. Therefore, be you perfect as your heavenly Father is perfect. In other words, you must arrive at a disposition to do good for all insofar as it is capability to you, and ultimately to see God in all things. Now this is difficult. This is the whole work of a lifetime, to be able to see Christ in others. Mother Teresa of Calcutta called the face of the poor, she said it was Christ's most distressing disguise. She never said that it was easy picking up the dead out of the streets of Calcutta. She never said it was easy to constantly deal with sickness and death. But it was Christ that she saw. And this is the key to the judgment. It's not about what we've done or how much we've done, it's what we see. And what we see, we know because of the way we respond. When we see God in all things, when we see Christ in all things, whether it's a beautiful little baby or my neighbor who's screaming at me. That I can come to the point of seeing God in both of these circumstances transforms everything and then necessarily transforms the way I act. So coming back to the question of the woman and her money. She would have made it, we understand from the story, she would have made it out of these fires of punishment if she hadn't shown that last one aggressive act of egoism. It's mine. And kicking them off as she's hanging on to her onion. Now because of the wounds of original sin, we all do that quite easily. We all go through our terrible twos, in which it's all about me. But what our Lord's grace is meant to do is that God heals us of this egocentrism in which I am so much part of my vocabulary. Me, myself, I, my rights, my rights, my rights, my rights, my rights, my rights, my rights. If anything indicates the move away from the gospel and Christianity, in the 20th and 21st century, it's this constant screaming about my rights and what's due to me. We almost never hear anyone say, what can I do for you? It's always about me. And so what we have on this judgment is we have two groups of people. And that's all there are. You're either in one group or you're in the other. You're either a sheep or you're a goat. And it's the difference between how we have arrived on the day of judgment and seeing the world. Grace is meant to heal that self-centeredness which afflicts all of us. And then it is meant to elevate us and to turn us toward God and our neighbor, which is why those two commandments are identified. The woman, of course, loses out because she only talks about herself. And that last moment of mercy given to her, she destroys because her disposition is about me. But this explains why between the sheep and the goats, both of them ask this question, including the righteous. When did we see you? Because what the goats are saying is, if we had known you, and you were sitting in prison wearing your crown and holding your staff, just like on my holy card, I could have come and seen you. And that's why our Lord says that since you did not do it to the least of my brethren, you did not do it to me. You did not see me around you. You saw yourselves, you goats. And then attach religion at certain moments in your life. That is not the healing and transformation of grace. But as I said, the amazing part about the sheep is they ask the same question. We never saw you with the crown of thorns and sitting on the holy card in prison. When did we do this for you? And he tells them, when you acted for those around you, you did it for me. Because that group saw God all around them. And they reacted accordingly by seeing God. This is a profound transformation of the way we see the world. Christianity is not something that's given to us so that we can have a couple pretty big holidays during the year. It is given that every day, every hour, every moment we transform, that we see Christ. That we see God in our children. That we see God in our spouses, our parents, our brothers, our colleagues. And that in seeing God, we react as our Lord describes, in mercy and compassion. And so as we come to the end of this liturgical year, and our desire is to be perfect as our Heavenly Father is perfect, we examine ourselves as to how well we are turned toward the other. And to ask each of ourselves how often the word I is part of what I say, what I write, how I think, me. How much is it part of what forms my character? And then to compare it to how often my consideration is about you, him, her, they. How much is it actually turning around, and we cannot do it because it's not easy. We're never going to be able to do it by nature. But by the participation in the divine mysteries, weekly, for some of you daily, we receive this gift of healing, which puts that balm of grace and that mercy of God over us, that says to us there is so much more in the world than just you, yourself, and the ego. And because of that fact, that healing, he then says to us, come up higher. And to rise to that level to see God and to see Christ in those around us and to react accordingly. And when grace heals and elevates us, we are guaranteed on that moment of judgment before the awesome throne of our Lord to be found among the sheep by the mercy of God, because that same judge is the one who gave us the ability to see otherwise in our lives and therefore to act in Christ-like manner. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. We believe in one God,
the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God of God, light of light, true God of true God, begotten of my name, consubstantial of the Father. Through him all things were made.
these offerings that your children have brought to you, out of their own for you and for your holy name, shower your spiritual blessings upon them in place of their earthly gifts, grant them life and your kingdom.
Amen.
As we remember our Lord God and Savior Jesus Christ in his plan of salvation for us, we recall upon this offering all those who have pleased God and commanded to this day, especially Mary, the Blessed Mother of God, St. Joseph Christos, St. Mary, St. Jude, and St. Charbel. Remember, O Lord, the children of the Holy Church, our fathers and mothers and our brothers and sisters, both living and the departed, especially those for whom the sacrifice is offered, for the repose of Buddy Eva Mitchell and the repose of Prunella Mitchell. Remember also all those who share with us today in this offering.
Show us.
the riches of your grace and kindness. May your compassion, assistance, sustain us all the days of our lives through the grace of your only Son and his love for all people. We glorify and honor you, your only Son, and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Holy God and Father, you sent your only Son to save us, for we are weak and poor. When we went astray, God has back to the spiritual fold by his royal blood. For your grace and the favor of the only Son, we implore you to accept this bloodless sacrifice from our sinful hand, and through it to forgive our sins. We glorify and honor you, your only Son, and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Beloved God, the Father, and the grace of the only begotten Son, and the communion in God with the Holy Spirit, be with you, my brothers and sisters, forever.
And with your spirit.
Let us lift up our thoughts, our minds, and our hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord with reverence, and worship him with humility. Shadow of Matthew. your burial, your glorious resurrection and ascension into heaven, your sitting at the right hand of God the Father, and your royal second coming, when you will judge all people and reward them according to their deeds. Now we ask you, and that fearful hour, have compassion on us, have mercy on us in your kindness, and forgive our sins in your mercy. For this your church implores you, and through you and with you implores your Father's sake.
Apostles, martyrs, confessors, and evangelists, John the Baptist. Baptist the forerunner, Stephen the archdeacon and first martyr, St. Joseph, St. Jude, St. Mary, St. Charbel, and all the saints, may we join in their ranks and share in their joyful feast. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, the faithful teachers who have gone to their rest in the true faith, especially Peter, Paul, Mark, Clement, Ignatius, Dionysius, Julius, and all those who endured suffering and persecution for the strengthening of your holy church. Remember also those who serve your altar and forgive their sins, that they may reach your joyful dwellings. We pray to you, O Lord.
Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
Bow your heads before the God of mercy. giving altar, and before the body and blood of our Savior, who gives life to those who partake of him, and receive the blessing from the Lord.
O Lord, look upon us, your inheritance, who bow before you, and guide our steps on your right path. Make us worthy to share in the sacrifice, and may it sanctify the souls and bodies of those who receive it. Through Christ Jesus, our Lord, we glorify and honor you, your only Son, and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
The grace of the Most Holy Trinity, eternal and consubstantial, be with you, my brothers and sisters, forever.
And with your Spirit.
Let each one of us look to God in reverence and humility, and ask him for mercy and compassion.
Holy gifts for the holy, with perfection, purity, and sanctity.
One Holy Father, one Holy Son, one Holy Spirit, blessed be the name of the Lord, for he is one in heaven and on earth, to him be glory forever. May us worthy, O Lord God, so that our lives may be sanctified by your holy body, and our souls purified by your forgiving blood. May our need be for the forgiveness of our sins, and for new life. O Lord our God, to you be glory forever.
made us worthy to share in the body and blood of your only begotten Son to save us. Through him and with him, glory and honor are due to you and to your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
Jesus Christ, our Lord and God, you are worshipped and you are holy. Bless and forgive the priests who are the stewards of your people and of your holy church. Forgive the servers of your divine mysteries and all the faithful who have shared in this sacrifice. Care for orphans, help widows, assist the poor and the distressed. Satisfy the hungry and protect all who call upon your holy name in every place. May your name be glorified in that of your Father and of your Holy Spirit, who is good, by the giving and consubstantial with you, now and forever. Go in peace, my beloved brothers and sisters, with the nourishment and blessings that you have received from the forgiving altar of the Lord. May the blessing of the Most Holy Trinity accompany you, Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, the one God, to whom be glory forever.